Well, good afternoon. We're ready to start, I think, a session that you're going to be not only informed, but also leave with some excitement. Our presenter today is Melanie Bunn, who is a gerontological nurse practitioner, which I might comment, we do not have enough in the Evansville area. So any of you who are nurses who would like to progress into your study, we need more, I think, of your specialty. Has over 30 years of experience in geriatrics and dementia care, worked with people living in nursing homes, worked with people and their care partners in a number of different settings, assisted living, acute care, and in the home. She's recognized for her interactive presentations and passionate commitment to improving lives of people living with dementia and those who care with and for them. She holds a baccalaureate from the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, Master of Science in Family Health Nursing with a concentration in gerontics from Clemson University, and a postmaster's gerontological nurse practitioner certificate from Duke University. A wonderful theoretical background, but wonderful practice. Pleased to have you here, Melanie. Welcome.
I am so glad to be with you to spend some time talking about something that makes a huge difference in the time we spend with people with dementia, and that's where they are along the progression of disease, because it makes an incredible difference, because the reason you don't tolerate taking a bath is completely different from the reason why you don't tolerate taking a bath, and is certainly different from the reason why you don't, and we don't even know what's going on with you, and certainly not her. And so it makes a difference with how we understand what people are doing and why they're doing and how life is going for them. So I think it's helpful sometimes to see if we can start out by agreeing on some things. So I have three things up there, and I'll see if we can agree on them. Do you agree that people with dementia are doing the best they can? Let me see. Do you agree with that? Yeah. Do you agree that we are doing the best we can? With what we know, with what we've got right now, with the resources and the information, I think we're doing the best we can in most situations. Do you agree that it's still difficult for the person with dementia and the person who's trying to help them? And that's one of the key things we're going to talk about, is that it's hard not just for us as caregivers, but it's hard for that person who's trying to live with dementia. So what I want you to do is find somebody close to you. Find somebody close to you. You're going to make friends with this person. So go ahead and find somebody who looks like they took their shower this morning. So you might want to look for somebody who's from in town, not somebody who drove in early this morning. So find somebody close to you. And what I want you to do is I want you to just reach out to that person, and I want you to just pat that person on the back of their hand and see how that goes. Now, y'all can pretty much live with that, can't you? You can live with that, but it's not going to stop there. Reach out and pat that person on their shoulder. Now, make sure they're not eating. You don't want to get anything to go the wrong way. And y'all don't mind that so much, do you? Now, reach out and pat the person on the top of their head. Now, take turns and make sure everybody gets payback. And y'all are giggling, so you like this a lot. You really enjoy it. Reach out and pat that person on their cheek. Now reach out and pat the person in the middle of their chest. And all of a sudden, everybody's going, I got that. Sorry, that's enough. I got it. We do things to people with dementia. Hear me. We do things to people with dementia that would get us kicked out of Target. And I mean that, because what happens if I'm standing in line behind her and we're at Target, and she is standing there minding her own business, but her tag is sticking out? Now, if I just reach out there and fix her tag, when she turns around, what is she going to look like? No, she's not. Make the real face she would look like. It's like Black Friday, and you've been shopping all night, and somebody got the last thing that you went in for. Now turn around and look at me. What do you look at me like? Oh, yeah. Be a little worse, wouldn't it? We do things to people with dementia that would get us kicked out of Walmart, because she would look at me and say, get your hands off of me, you tramp. What do you think you're doing? And when people with dementia do the same thing, we think, who's got the problem? They've got the problem. The most of the time, who's got the problem? We're the ones with the problem most of the time. So it's still difficult, and it's difficult for the person helping, and it's difficult for the person being helped. So it's all about the relationship. It's all about the relationship, because here's a secret. We are a lot more alike people with dementia than we are different from them. We have a lot more in common with them than we do different from them. And because we have the same basic needs, the same basic drives, the same basic wants, except people with dementia are in brain failure. Now say that with me. Brain failure. Say it really loud so they can hear it down the hall, because more than likely the people who need this talk aren't in this room. Brain failure. Because we forget that what's going on with the person with dementia is their brain is failing. Now, I know there's some healthcare people in the room and some families in the room. Is there a nurse around somewhere? I already picked on her, though. Okay, so I'll get you.
No.
Now, here's what happened. I'm a nurse, and I go up to my patient, and she's got congestive heart failure. Now, if she's got congestive heart failure, what are your symptoms going to be? You're going to be real short of breath. So you be short of breath. Now, Miss Powell, breathe better.
You tried to breathe.
Now, you could breathe yesterday. Now, why won't you breathe? You know, she's always been stubborn. Would I do that? Why not? I want to keep my practice, right? Would I walk up to somebody with kidney failure? Would you lean forward for me, please? Go, kidneys, go. Go, kidneys, go. Would I do that? Why not? It doesn't work, and it's really annoying. So those are two really good reasons why not to do it. Now, who else is in healthcare? You've kind of got on that T-shirt like you work somewhere. So here's what happens. I walk up to you, and I'm your nurse, and I say, now, don't get up until I come back. You're going to wait for me? You're going to wait for me? Now, don't get up till I come back. You're going to wait for me. Now, if you need help before I come back, take this button. Push 49, 73, 112, star, apostrophe S, square root, 9,463, okay? Okay. And I turn around, as soon as I turn around, what are you doing up? Now, which one of us is going to get the drugs? Which one of us probably needs the drugs? And so it's about the person's brain is dying. Structurally and chemically, and the type of dementia and the level of dementia, all of these things make a difference. We're not going to talk so much about structure and chemical and type, because we're here to talk mostly about progression. But I wouldn't be doing you a good service if I didn't at least mention it briefly. So these are brains. Now, how many of y'all have seen these brains before with Tipa? Many of y'all have seen the brains before. So tell me the three differences between the brains. The size is going to shrink down to 1/3 of size. What else is different about those two brains? The crevices are deeper, because as the brain cells die, they collapse and fluid fills up. What's the other difference? The color, they're darker because the debris and inflammation builds up in there. And so these two brains, when you look at them, it's really clear which one of these two brains can learn new information, the one on the left or the one on the right. Which one of those brains can take that new information and apply it to a new situation, the one on the left or the one on the right? Which one of those brains do you have? Here's a better question. Which one of those brains do you sometimes act like you have? Have you ever wound up in an argument with a person with dementia? It gets away from you really fast. Now, there's one more thing I need to tell you about these brains. They were men. And that's very important. Very, very important. And the reason it's very, very important is because they were both men. They were the same age. They were the same ethnicity. They were the same size. They had the same head circumference. So the only difference between these two men is this man died from an accident. And I'm not going to push another button. That man died from his Alzheimer's. So when we think about the impact of these changes in the brain, this is the hippocampus, this is the memory part of the brain. It's more than just memory, though, but it starts with memory. And the kind of memory that people lose is from recent to remote. And that's why I truly can remember things that happened years and years and years ago, and I truly can't remember things that happened recently, because early on, it's more of a storage problem than a retrieval problem. So it's that people can't get new information in. They can use what's in there, but they can't get new information in. This is vision, and up there you see lots of tissue, and there you see lots of loss. And so what happens, look straight forward, put your hands out, bring your fingers forward without moving your eyes so you can see your fingers, and it's all the way around, and that's your field of vision. With people with dementia, what happens is it narrows down to this. It goes on. It narrows to this. It goes on. It narrows to this. So put one binocular on and close one eye, and now bend over and pick something up off the floor and see what happens. Something that's usually very easy becomes what? Very hard. So life changes. This is hearing. It's not a hearing problem. It's an understanding problem. And so people lose their ability to understand what's going on. So we wind up in situations like, listen, I didn't have that one. I'm really done, but I didn't have that one. Now, listen, here's what's going on. Now, I think I'm going to hop in there, all right? The last time I hit it, I'm hitting it, all right? I'm in. I'm going to have it. All right? I'm going to have it.
No.
It'll be all right. Yeah. It'll be all right. It'll be all right. Okay. Now, which one of us has the problem? Which one of us has dementia? He thinks I did.
Yeah.
And he was pretty determined that I did, because he was determined not to say yes, because he knew what was coming, didn't you?
Yeah.
Okay. So I didn't accept his no, and when I didn't accept his no, what happened? You got very distressed, right? Was his behavior appropriate? Because if I'd have sent him back there with no pants on, you'd have moved, wouldn't you? And so he's doing the best he can. So we call his behavior appropriate in this situation, but if he's got dementia, what kind of words do we use to describe him? We say he's what? Belligerent. What else? Uncooperative. What else? Resistant. What else? Difficult. What else? Stubborn, combative, when he really isn't. He was trying so hard not to get in trouble. Thank you for being a good sport. Give him a hand. He did good. And so people are losing their ability to really understand what we're doing. They're losing their ability to put what they feel with what their responses are. because of the loss of the gray matter and the white matter. They're losing their expressive language, so their ability to tell us what they need. And he was trying so hard to tell me he really didn't want that to happen. Even when he was accurate, I still didn't listen to him. So people say things, but we don't really listen to what they're telling us. So I had a man who walked up to a group of ladies who were eating their lunch. And my gentleman walked up. He said, hey, baby, listen, I got to tell you something. It's going to rain. Okay, baby, listen, I'm telling you, baby, listen, you better listen, I'm telling you, it's getting ready, it's going to rain. Okay, listen, baby, listen, I'm telling you, you better get ready, it's going to rain. And he unzipped, and it rained. And so even when they're doing what they can to tell us what's going on, we don't listen to them. Other language gets involved too. And this is the three things, and y'all have heard TIPA often. What are the three things that are protected? Music and rhythmic speech. Automatic speech kind of things. And cuss words, sex words, and racial slurs. And they're protected because they're in that part of the brain. As well as we have problems with that frontal lobe. We have problems with that person's ability to really take information in, process it, decide how to respond, and follow rules. So y'all know a lot of rules. This is the part of the brain that allows you to behave differently at a football game, a basketball game. Y'all are basketball. That lets you behave differently at a basketball game than you do at a wedding. And this is the part of the brain that allows you, if you're sitting in this room and something itches, allows you to decide what you're going to do about it. Because if certain things itch, you're just going to what? Scratch. If other things itch, she advises wiggling. Any other suggestions up there? So people will slip out to the bathroom. If you've got dementia and it itches, what are you going to do? Scratch it. Does it matter that you're in church? It doesn't matter. They lose that ability to think things through, to think if, then. And this impulse control is one of the earliest things we see in the changes that we're dealing with. PET scans, normal PET scans, y'all have seen these. What happens? Healthy 20-year-old, these are the people you'll see walking around campus when school's back in. Healthy 80-year-old, these people you see walking around campus when school is back in. Not healthy brains. This first one is a normal brain, early Alzheimer's, late Alzheimer's, and then an 18-month-old baby. And what you're looking at is where it's red is where it's working. Where it's red is where things are connecting. And what do you notice changes in those brains as time goes on? There's less red. So there's less processing. There's less understanding. Different types of dementia. You've got that as a resource. But that's not what we're here for today. Because what we're here for today is to talk about progression of disease. Now, I have seen a lot of systems of monitoring dementia. And I don't like any of them. And the reason I don't like any of them is because they're all very negative. And they're all very focused on what people can't do. Now, I'm thinking that some of y'all are a little bit like me, that if I'm in this room and this banister right here says, wet paint, do not touch. If that banister says that, how many of y'all want to just sneak up here and just touch and just see if it still is wet? When you tell people, thank you for admitting that. When you tell people what not to do, it becomes very distracting, and that's all they can think about. So when we tell people what people are losing, that becomes very distressing, and that's all they can think about. And so when people are thinking about all the losses, they can't think about what's left. And so I like this model that an occupational therapist developed, and TIPA did some adaptation with. I worked with her on part of that, to think about not just what people can't do anymore, but to really start thinking about what can people still do. And so what she did was, with the work that we did, is she added on the idea that people are valuable. And because people are valuable, we're going to name them after gems. And so the earliest people in this disease, the earliest people we're talking about, are people who are at the diamond level of dementia. And so people who are very early on, these are people who are still living in their homes. They're still really doing well. They can do fine as long as they're doing what? The way they've always done it. So these are people who love their routines. They're in their routines. They can do really well as long as they're in their routines. And so we call them diamonds because they are rigid. They are hard. They don't change, but you put them in the right situation, and guess what they can do? They can really shine when they're in the right situation. But you mess with them and you change them up and things get really hard for them. So they do really well as long as they're in their routines. They like their habits and their routines. They are really good as long as they're in control. They're really good as long as they're independent. They can still do, some of them look better than their caregivers because the caregiver is starting to look a little ragged. The person with dementia still looks pretty good. They make it look a little more than they used to, but they still look pretty good. They can still see things and respond. They can still tell you what they need, but they're struggling. And what they're struggling with is they're struggling when things are different. They're struggling when things aren't the way they used to be. They're struggling when we try to take over. They're struggling. They get anxious and frustrated and lost and confused, and they misplace things, and life doesn't work exactly the way it used to work. And they have trouble with abstractions, and they have trouble making things make sense. So the kinds of things you'll see from these kind of people is they say and do the things that y'all think that because of your filters, you don't do. So I had a lady who walked up to the pastor after the funeral of her best friend. And she walked up to the pastor and she said, "Thank you so much. That was a beautiful sermon. That was just beautiful. I can tell you, you brought back so many memories of her. Thank you so much. That was just beautiful. Can I ask you one question? I've always heard that bald-headed men are good in bed."
That's not very appropriate to be talking to your pastor that way.
Now, is that true? I was just curious about it. Well, let me ask your wife.
That's my wife.
Now, listen, I've always heard that men, as they lose their hair, they get better in bed. Now, what do you think about that? And their daughter's going, "La, la, 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 la."
That's right.
Would you ever? They will. They'll say things and do things that you never, ever, 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 ever would have expected them to say and do because they lose those filters, they're losing that language, and they get into all kinds of trouble. So what we want to do is we want to keep their routines. We want to keep them doing things the way they've been doing them. We want to, if something works, get some extras so you don't have to worry about it not working in the future. This is the hard one. Let go of those little mistakes. Let go of the things that don't make much difference. Because we make a big deal out of things that are really, really small. So I had a lady whose favorite granddaughter was getting married. And her family went out and took her shopping, and they bought her a beautiful lavender suit because it was a spring wedding. So all of the people were wearing light-colored pastel colors, beautiful lavender suit. The morning of the wedding came, lavender suit was hanging on the back of the closet. She got up, she put on the lavender suit. She went and she looked in the mirror and she said, "I look good, but I could look better." So she went back to the closet, and she came out with a red feather boa, bright yellow gloves, orange boots, and a Kelly green pashmina. And she went to the mirror, and she stood in the mirror, and she said, "I look good, but I could look better." And she went back to the closet, and she got out all the jewelry that her 19 grandchildren had given her over the years, and she put it all on, including clip-on earrings all the way around. And she walks out, and she looks in the mirror, and she says, "I look good." And off they go to the wedding. Well, her daughter comes to pick her up. Her daughter walks in, looks at her mom in the attire, and says, "Oh, Mom." Now, the daughter gets to make a decision. Who gets to make the decision? The daughter gets to make the decision. And what is the decision the daughter gets to make? Is she going to tangle or is she going to tango? Is she going to dance or is she going to fight? Now, how many of y'all, just think about it for a minute, how many of y'all really want to fix that person with dementia? Particularly at this level, how many of y'all really want to make them be right? Make them follow the rules and make them behave the way they should. Is it ever going to happen? And that's why I showed you those brain pictures. Because if you can't fill up those holes in their brain, guess what? You just got to go with the flow and let go. You've got what you've got. And so what happened was the daughter said, "Oh, Mom, you look so festive." And Mom goes, "Thank you, I tried." And off they go to the wedding. Well, the mother texts the daughter from the car and says, "Grandma's coming, you won't miss her." And when you look at the pictures of the wedding, you notice Grandma. You don't miss her. But you mainly notice, because what does her face look like? She is glowing with joy because this precious granddaughter is bringing this precious grandson into their family. And so, a new grandson. They're not marrying like that or anything. But and so it's a time for celebration for this family, and Grandma's part of it. And she's part of it because they understood that it's better to accept people than it is to correct them. We're going to talk about some magic words. So important that I actually want you to say them afterward, okay? I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. I'm so very sorry. And you better practice those words, because if you don't say them, you will be. Because when that person makes a mistake, if you let it be okay, and if you say, "I'm sorry, I know that's really frustrating," then you have the relationship and things go better for everybody. Now, what we're going to do is I'm going to let you do a little bit of practice with this. So what I want you to do is I want you to find a partner. So you need two people. So find a partner. And what I want you to do is decide who's going to be the person with dementia and who's going to be the caregiver. And what has happened is the caregiver has given the person with dementia what they need to wash their face. And the person with dementia doesn't wash his or her face. And so the caregiver returns and finds that the person with dementia has not washed his or her face and tries to help. So I've got it scripted out for you. So decide who's going to be the caregiver. The caregiver's going to do the stuff in red. The person with dementia is going to do the stuff in black. So the caregiver's going to, caregiver, stand up. And I want you to rush up to your person and say, "What's the matter? Why haven't you washed your face?" And person with dementia say, "Oh, I don't know. Of course I wash my face. I wash my face every morning." And then the caregiver says, "No, you haven't," and try to help them. And then the person with dementia says, "Push that away. You're a terrible person." And then just continue that for just a second. So find your person. Caregiver, stand up. Now, some of y'all know how to do this. Put your hands on your hips. Hip to one side, bring up that finger, and tell him what's wrong. So go for it.
What's
All righty. Now change roles. The person who was helping now gets payback time. So if you were helping, you now get to help. And if you were being helped, you now get to help. So do the exact same thing. So rush into your person's. All right, take a deep breath and let it go. And take a deep breath and let it go. Now look at that person and say, I forgive you for being a jerk. I know you were just doing the best you could. Then look at yourself. I forgive you for being a jerk. I was just doing the best I could. Because with people at this level of diamonds, we get into a lot of trouble. I'm going to give you a minute. I'm going to give you a minute. And you almost never get this time. So take advantage of it. I'm going to give you a minute to just think. And what I want you to think about is, what was it like for you when that person was telling you as an adult what you were supposed to do and pointing out your mistakes in front of people? So I'm going to give you a minute. I want you to think about that, okay? On your mark, get set, think. Okay, stop thinking. For some of y'all, that's the first time you've had a minute to think in quite a while, isn't it? I can tell, because it was uncomfortable for some of y'all. And some of y'all, now I want you to take the same minute, it's payback, take the same minute, and I want you to talk to the people around you. What was it like for you when that person was telling you what to do? What was it like for you? And you get that same, well, not that same minute, a different minute, but equal time. Alrighty, so now take a deep breath and let it go and call out some of those reactions. My ears still haven't unpopped from my flight here this morning, so you really are going to have to call them out. If you don't yell, tell the person next to you. What were some of those experiences like? Sad. You felt sad? Tell me more. You were mad? You could be sad or you could be mad. Yeah, what else? Yes, ma'am. Humiliated. Anybody else have feelings of feeling humiliated? Feeling, yeah. What other feelings? What? Guilty later when you were the understanding? Yeah. What other feelings? confusion and then anger. Your first experience was, what are you doing? What? Stop it. Any others? Invasion of personal space? Was there some? What?
Defeated.
Thank you. Defeated. I just kind of with. I might as well not even. She's not listening to me. I might as well just hide back in my. How would you like if your life was like that all the time? Because for many people with dementia, all they hear is no, don't. And what they live their lives with is a no, don't. So find that person next to you. Put your hand up like this. And give them a little push. And say, you can't do that. And what do you automatically say back? And then push harder. No, you can't. No, you can't. And pretty soon what you find out is you're starting to sweat. But you're not going anywhere. So we've got to let go of that kind of thing. When you were the caregiver, have you seen this kind of care being done? By people who love the person with dementia, by people who love their jobs. But we get so distressed and so focused on the job, we forget about the person we're trying to spend time with. And we have a lot of responsibility. How many of y'all only do one thing in your life? Yeah, how many of y'all have two main things you do in your life? How many of y'all have three main things you do in your life? How many of y'all have six main things you do in your life? I mean, we all are really busy doing lots of stuff. And what happens to us as loving people, what happens is this. Now do this with me, please. Bring your shoulders up like this. Bring your hands up like this. Pull your mouth to one side, squint one eye. Now look at the person next to you and say, but I'm only trying to help you. Because the truth is, that's what a lot of y'all look like by the end of your day. Or by the end of your visit. Or by the end of whatever is going on. Take a deep breath and let it go. Because what happens when you're like this is the person with dementia looks at you and says, help! They're not going to do anything. So when you're stressed and you're distressed, you see this kind of care. Have you seen this kind of care? When you were the caregiver, how were you feeling inside? I know what you looked like. What were you feeling like? Frustrated? Tight. Tense and tight? What else? Overwhelmed? Because I don't think people do this because they don't want to do the right thing. They do it because they're frustrated, they're overwhelmed, and life is just complicated. So what other kinds of things could this caregiver in this situation try? 30 seconds to think about it, 30 seconds to talk about it. Are you ready? 30 seconds to think. What could that caregiver try instead? Now you're 30 seconds to talk. What could the caregiver do differently? Alrighty, so what are some of the things that caregiver could try? Demonstration, have the person give, and what kind of cue is that when you demonstrate? Visual cue, do visual cues work with these diamond people? Does showing them what to do work with them? Yeah, absolutely. What else could you maybe try? Let it go for a while. Do you know many people who died from a dirty face? And the truth is, people die from not being in relationship. People die from not being cherished and not being loved. People with dementia don't die from not getting a bath. And we get so upset about this stuff and so excited about this stuff that we forget about what the person is, what the person's saying, what the person's doing. And so what happens is we get into these pushing things. So you're my caregiver, I'm your person with dementia, and I'm at this level. And whether you come to see me in my home, or whether you're my family member, or whether I'm in a care facility, wherever I am, I need a shower. And you can tell from way outside the room that I need a shower. It's been way too long. So you tell me I need a shower.
You need a shower.
I've already had my shower.
You stink.
What do you mean I stink? If you smell something, it's your own nasty self. No. You tramp hussy.
No.
Now listen, I'm sick of you coming in here. I have got my grown-up clothes on. I have had my stinking shower.
Well.
Tramp hussy. Now, is she going to win? She's not going to win because I told her exactly why I didn't need a shower. What did I tell her? And how do I know I've already had one? I've got my grown-up clothes on. Now, how many of y'all got up this morning, got dressed, and then went and took your showers? We expect people with dementia to do things that don't make sense, that aren't logical. And so we have to kind of change our ideas of thinking about what people with dementia mean and do. So we're going to talk about the next few levels. The emeralds, these are people who are green, and green on the stoplight stands for, and these are people who are on the go. They are busy, they are going back in the past, they are making lots of mistakes. When they make mistakes, is it their problem or is it yours? It is your problem, because can you explain to them what their problem is? Let it go of trying to make them fix the way they used to be. Now you have a lot of information about how to help them visually. These are folks, if you don't find something for them to do, guess what they will do? They will find something to do. And what they find to do, is it going to be what you want them to do? It is not going to be what you want them to do. They struggle with making mistakes. They struggle with doing things that are not right. They get into a lot of trouble because things don't work. So what happens is I get dressed. I wish you would quit buying me this cheap stuff. It's terrible. It's just pulling, and it's ugly.
It is.
Well, whose business is it of yours if my ugly clothes? Yours aren't so pretty yourself. They're a little evener than mine. Look at that. That is just ridiculous. Because I can say my clothes are ugly, but guess what? You better be real careful saying my clothes are, but you got to agree with me. But yeah, so what are we going to do now about it? Do you think I've got something better? Because you know that trampy daughter of mine picks out all this stuff.
Let's go shopping.
Oh, we can go shop? Yeah, here, you can have this. All righty, good job. I like to shop. Give her a hand. She did good. They don't want to be helped. They still want privacy. So how we help them is by agreeing with them. Now, how many of y'all like it when somebody agrees with you? Doesn't that make you feel real good? The person goes up 10 friendship points if they agree with you. And so we're going to talk about a way of communicating with these folks that is only three steps. Now, I do a lot of my work at Duke, and I love my work at Duke. I'm involved in some fantastic projects. But the problem is anything that comes out of Duke has got to have 27 steps. Now, how many of y'all can remember 27 steps? On a good day, I can't remember 27 steps. I can remember three. Can y'all remember three? On a bad day, can you remember three? Yeah, even on a bad day, you can remember three. So the first step is start with the feelings. It sounds like you're really upset. It looks like you're really angry. It seems like you're really frustrated. The second step, tell me about it. Tell me about it. Now, this is the one that y'all don't really love to do. You don't want to tell me I look angry because you're afraid what's going to happen. I'm going to get angry. Guess what? I'm already there. And so what we've got to do is we've got to let go of trying to make the person, the worst words in the world for a person with my opinion, look at the person and say, look at the person next to you, and just look at them very intimately and say, now just calm down. Exactly. Yeah. Because when you say calm down, it means you what? You do not understand what is going on in my life. So if I'm very angry, I'm very upset, or I can't find my son. Have any of y'all ever been responsible for a young child in a busy place? What happens when you turn around and that young child isn't there? Panic, sheer terror and panic down in the heart and soul of your being. When that person with dementia can't find that child, it's just like that to them. So when I can't find Matthew, he was just here and I can't find him. Oh God, can you help me? Okay, now what does he want to say? What's going around his brain? He's going, just calm down. But give him a hand because he didn't say it. Melanie, you look so, I can't find Matthew. He was here just a minute ago and now I can't find him. Melanie, you look so.
Oh, I'm sorry. Melanie, you look so upset.
I am upset. I can't. Now, what does he need to look like?
Like I'm concerned.
Upset and concerned, too. Because if he looks like he's happy, I think what? You took him!
Yeah.
You're hiding him under the sink. So what's your next line?
You want me to go help you look for him?
Okay. So what's going to happen if he goes to look for him? That's what? That's that lying kind of stuff? Because are we going to find him? Yeah. So does that work? Because I'm not stupid. I've just got dementia. So is it going to work to say we'll go find him? Because even if we find the son, or is it the son I'm looking for? Because the one I'm looking for is, and the one you find is, and that's not going to work because that's my cheating ex-husband. So tell me about Matthew. Well, he's a boy. Do you know anything about boys?
Yes, I do.
Oh, well, you know they're busy then.
Yeah, always busy.
Now, he's a good boy. Now, he's not one of those ugly ones. Yeah. He's a good boy. He tries real hard.
Yeah.
But he is a boy. So, you know, he likes to
get into stuff.
Oh, he does. You know, don't you?
Yeah, I've got two boys.
Oh, well, then you do know, don't you? Oh, yeah. So now we have what? We have that connection, right? And now we need to go do something. Not go find Matthew, but we need to go find pictures of Matthew. We need to find something that I used to do for with Matthew that'll make us have that connection and bring us all together. Now, the next level we're going to talk about are the Ambers. These are people who are very busy, but yellow on the stoplight stands for caution. And these are people we're really worried about as far as safety, because they are into everything. These are people who pick up things and they carry them around, and it doesn't matter if it's mine or if it's not. And they pick it up and they just drink it. Oh, yeah, that's mine. And they have all kinds of stuff that they've got. I had one lady walk up to me and she smiled. And she had the biggest smile you've ever seen. She had top teeth. She had bottom teeth. She had another set of top teeth. Because she saw somebody's dentures. And what do you do with dentures? So they pick up things, they carry them around. They're very, very busy. It's all about sensation. It's all about moving around. So the things that still work, they still can do things when we show them what to do. They can still respond to visual cues. So look at the person next to you and give that person some kind of a cue of something you want to do. So show them. You want them to stand up. You want them to come, you want to hug, you want to shake hands, and just do a couple of those and see how easy those are to understand. So turn to the person next to you and just do three or four, kind of. And even late, yeah, you know how to do that. Now the problem is, go from this to this. And we leave out those visual cues. And they're really critically important for these people. So we leave out those visual cues of showing people what we want them to do. They can still imitate us. They can still do stuff. They've got a lot that's still working. They don't want to be handled. They're very interested in the parts of their bodies with lots of nerve endings. And there are important parts of your body with lots of nerve endings that we're very grateful for. Your mouth, lips, and tongue. Palms of your hands. Soles of your feet. There's one more. Anybody know where it is? Genitalia. Lots of nerve endings here. Lots of nerve endings here. You put them together, and it's the 4th of July. And it's not masturbation. It's not sex. It just simply makes things in your brain connect. And people with dementia crave connection in their world. They crave connection in their brains. And so when the brain cells are far apart, you get very, very interested in things that make brain cells connect. And that makes, ask many people you know, that makes brain cells connect. They need help, but they don't like to be managed. So we're going to think about visual cues with gestures. We're going to think about simplifying. We're going to think about helping them. We're going to think about the environment. So your homework is, I want you to go to the place where people live, whether it's in a care facility or whether it's in your own home or whether it's in somebody else's home. I want you to go to that place, and I want you to take photographs or video of that place. Because what you'll notice when you look at the photos or the video, you'll notice all kinds of things that your brain filters out, that your brain doesn't pay any attention to because you have a healthy brain that can filter things. But that person with dementia, they see all of that stuff without filters. I want you to close your eyes and just sit in that place where that situation happens, where people live, where people get dressed, where people take baths. Sit in that place where people eat. Close your eyes and listen. Do it right here. Close your eyes and just listen and see what you hear. Are you aware of things you didn't notice before? What did you notice? The air conditioner. I had a lady who would yell at her daughter every time she came. She said, "You just need to take me to the beach. You promised me you. It's just right outside my way. If you would just take me to the beach, we would be your tramp, just take me to the beach." Because the air in her room sounded like what? The waves. And so when we really look at the world through the perspectives of people with dementia, when we really look at it through their vision and their hearing and their processing, the world makes sense. And so we have to do that because they can't tell us what's going on. These are people, when it's not working, back off, change something, and try again. Say it with me. Back off, change something, try again. Because what happens is I go in to help her wash her face, and it really doesn't go well, and she gets very upset. If I keep pushing, what's going to keep happening? She's going to spiral. I'm going to spiral. It's not going to go well. Back off, change something, and try again. Rubies, we're going to talk about. These are people, red on the stoplight stands for, and these are people who are slowing down and stopping. They're on or they're off. Their world is getting very, very small. So everybody stand up. Put your feet a little distance apart. Bend your knees a little bit. Kind of bend over a little bit. Put your arms down. Kind of half close your eyes. Little bit. Now walk around your table. Kind of get your knees bent, kind of keep hung over. Now what do you notice about how your body is feeling? Your balance is off. What else are you noticing? You just see the floor. What else are you noticing? What if you're really doing it with your feet wide, what's starting to happen? Your balance is not good. What else is happening? Your hips start to give. What else starts to happen? Your knees start to hurt a little bit. What else starts to happen?
Your back hurt,
your shoulder. And so when I want you to get up and walk around, what are you going to say? Numb, because it what? It hurts. Take a deep breath. Take a big yawn. Put your right hand up on the top of your head and just let the weight of your arm just pull your ear softly to your shoulder. Put your left hand up across your head. Let the weight of your arm pull it softly to your shoulder. Roll your shoulders back 3 times. 1, 2, 3. Take a big yawn. Look at the person next to you and say, thank you so much for what you're doing. Say, I am so glad you came today. Now sit back down. These are folks who their world is getting so small, they're very interested in only those parts of their body where things are really connecting really well. And so we give them all kinds of, we interpret their behavior in all kinds of way that really aren't helpful. And so at this level, what I'm doing is I'm sitting here and I'm going, hip, 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 hip. And what do y'all want me to do? Stop going, help, 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 because the children are trying to sleep in the next room if the person is at home, or because somebody in the down the hall is trying to sleep, or someone's at the end of their life, or there's a new family, or there's something. And so they send her in to help me. So just rub my back a little bit. Help, help, yeah. And so y'all think she's magic, isn't she? And she stops and she goes back to work to do something. Hep, 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 hep. And she comes back. Hep, hep, yeah. Now, what do y'all call that behavior? I am exhibiting what kind of behavior?
Attention
seeking. I am trying to get her, and the other one people call that is manipulative. Is that, can that brain really manipulate or sink attention? What's happening is when she's there, it's what? It's better. When she's gone, it's what? Empty. And what do we know? People don't want their world to be empty. So reach out of that person next to you and just rub their shoulder a little bit and let them rub yours back. It's nice, isn't it? So at this point, I'm stopping stuff. I'm stopping medications. I'm stopping treatments. I'm not weighing people, not because I don't care, but because I need to do a different kind of care, because I need to pay attention to things that will make a difference. And at this level, the things that make a difference are those connecting things. It's making sure people are comfortable. Alzheimer's disease does not cure arthritis. And so people who can't tell us they are having pain are often having pain. So that calling out often is expression of pain, and we still need to manage and treat those kinds of things. The last level are pearls, and these are people who are really living inside themselves. This is the end of life, and this is when things are shutting down, and the world is getting very, very small. Our bodies are made in such a miraculous way, so amazing our bodies are made, that as people are losing their ability to chew and to swallow, they're also losing their ability to absorb nutrients. And so it's not like the children we see who aren't getting access to food. It truly is. At this level of people's lives, their endorphins go up. And if we support people doing what should happen, the way it naturally should happen, it's a very peaceful, easy time of life. If we spend our time putting things in there that the person just has to work really hard to get back out, it doesn't go so well. Tube feedings in people at this level with progressive dementia, not effective. They don't reduce onset of pneumonia. They don't make people gain weight. They don't help with healing wounds. They just create additional discomfort and additional technology, an additional kind of having to manage stuff that keeps us from paying attention to that person. So there's people end of life. We really need to make sure we keep people's skin moist, to make sure that we manage pain, but to really make sure we connect, whether it's singing with somebody or whether it's praying with somebody or whether it's telling them stories or just kind of telling them that I care about you and I'm really glad to see you. Sometimes the caring we do is, I'm going to miss you, but it's time. It's okay if you need to go. And sometimes that's the caring that we say to people with dementia. So when we think about cueing, the order of cueing, visual, verbal, tactile, it's still a person, it's still a human being with individual needs, and we still need to be willing to try and change ourselves. The difference in the progression is the strength of the cueing, because that person that's a pearl, that person who's inside that shell, not going to respond so much to visual cues anymore, not going to respond so much to verbal cues anymore, might respond to your presence, to the present of your presence, and to gentle touch and smells and things like that. The response time is going to change. It's going to take people up to a count of 10 to respond as we go through the disease. So key conclusions, let go. And let go of things being the way they used to be, of things being right. Let go of that person being the way they used to be. I have volunteered and led an Alzheimer's support group since about 1989. And it's one of the most important things I've done in my life, because I've learned so much from those people about dementia, about caregiving. We have never in all of those years in that support group have we sat on beanbag chairs. We've never burned incense. And we've never sung Kumbaya. But it is a place where we can talk about feelings and experiences and what life is like when that person isn't who raised you, or that person isn't that person that you admitted 8 years ago to this organization. The last two things I'm going to leave you with are two quotes from two favorite people that I like to read. And the first one is Anne Lamott, and she says, "It's better to be kind than to be right." It's better to be kind than to be right. And I will tell you, in my practice, in my life, I treat the majority of people that I meet and interact with like they've got dementia. And I'm not, it's true. Because most people, if you're kind to them and you don't try to prove how much smarter you are, or how much better you are, or how much more you know, the relationship heals and life goes better. And life is just better for all of us. The last one is a Dr. Seuss quote. "Sometimes you never know the value of a moment until it becomes a memory." And so all we have with people with dementia is this moment. We don't have the past. We don't have the future. All we've got right now is this moment. So I want you to turn to that person next to you and just shake hands with that person and look them in their eyes and say, "Thank you so much for what you're doing.
Thank you
for being here today. I'm so glad you're here." Now, I think I am close to out of time. Is there somebody, a grown-up here who's in charge? I think the grown-up who's in charge is saying, "I'm out of time." Like, "I'm out of time." But is there like a break or something? So there's a break. So just go ahead and give me that I didn't give you time to ask questions. I never do. But I'll hang around up here if anybody's got any questions. So come talk to me. Thank y'all so much for coming. Thanks for being good sports when I picked on you.